I have a phone bill, an electricity bill, and I thought I'd paid the mortgage this month, but I haven't. The bank is losing patience. And the washing machine won't start. 6 months after the third anniversary of Russell's death, and I still haven't scattered his ashes. I'd really wanted to do it this year and had thought we should do it in the backyard. Why make a big production? We'd scattered the ashes and plant a rosemary bush because he loved the smell of rosemary. And then the big, gnarled fig tree growing on the back wall had come down in a storm, bringing the wall with it, which my mother had been warning about for years. And the garden was a mess and insurance didn't pay for it. It's taken me this long to get the back wall rebuilt. And now the washing machine won't start and the ashes are still in their ugly plastic container. And as I struggle to get my life together, whatever that might mean, things are falling apart. I'm Sophie Townsend, and this is Goodbye to All This, an original podcast from the BBC World Service. Chapter 10, Appointment. I can't afford the new washing machine right now. I remember a time years ago that the same thing had happened and Russell had unscrewed the back off and played around and it started again. He wasn't really handy in that way, usually, so he'd been so proud of himself, had told everyone how clever it was, and the story had got more elaborate and more heroic over the many months he talked about it. I was pretty sure that he just flicked a switch. So I unscrewed the back of the washing machine, and there's a circuit board that looks like it isn't sitting right, a wire leading from somewhere to somewhere, pushing it forward, so it sort of hangs in midair. So I get my screwdriver and push the wire away, and there's a flash of light and a crack, and the house is plunged into darkness. And my neighbour comes round and looks at the damage to the fuse box out the front of my house and says, I should have turned the power off. Lucky you didn't electrocute yourself, he says, as he looks at the blown fuses and shakes his head. He gives me the number for an emergency electrician. I can't really afford an emergency electrician. But there's not a lot I can do except pay on a credit card and add to what I already owed the bank. He asks how it happened and I tell him that I tried to fix the washing machine, like my husband had once done. He probably made sure the power was off, he says. I pay him with my card, trying not to think about the worsening balance. It's raining hard, that sort of rain that makes everything impossible. Everything is soggy and everyone is irritated. I have to get to an appointment at 1, a half-hour drive away, and I'm waiting for the delivery of our new washing machine, which they told me would arrive between 9:30 and 12:30. I'm gambling on them coming earlier rather than later, which, considering the cancellation fee for my appointment if I don't show, now seems like a bad bet. It's 11:45. I notice the truck coming up the road and moving further away from our house as the driver searches for a parking spot. This truck has the new washing machine in it. The washing machine I can't really afford, but I try to remember that despite all the debts and the bills, that I'm lucky I can get a washing machine in an emergency. And I'll pay off the credit card eventually, and it will be okay. The truck eventually stops in front of the little lane half a block down the road, which to the driver looks like it won't be a problem, but it is a problem because it means that several of my neighbours won't be able to get their cars out if they need to. Do I tell them or do I let them park and make the delivery and hope the neighbours are staying in? I look at the time and the rain and I cross my fingers and hope. Two men wheeled the washing machine in its box in the rain up the road. By the time they get to the front step, they're soaking wet and annoyed. "There's not enough places to park on this street," one of them says to me, accusingly, as if I specifically chose this street to live on the off chance that by doing so, I'd be able to inconvenience a man bringing me my new washing machine someday. "Come in," I say. I'm trying for a bright, welcoming, calming tone, but it comes out brisk and irritated, as if he's chosen to deliver washing machines in a giant truck on the off chance of inconveniencing me on my narrow street on a rainy day. The two men standing in my hallway now are both damp and cold, and they just want to get this done. I want them to get it done too, and I start to lead them out to the laundry, where they'll install the new washing machine and take the old one away, for which I'm paying $200 extra, because I don't know what else to do. I think about Russell, how he would have installed the new washing machine himself, reading the instructions carefully, lifting the machine up onto the dryer, with me there to help keep it steady. There are lots of people I could ask to help me, but I don't want to. I don't want to tell them my stupid story about the washing machine and not making sure the power was off. And I don't want them saying I'm lucky to be alive. And I don't want help taking the old one to the tip. So with mounting debt on the credit card that would never have been there if Russell were alive, I paid the extra money. And the men get to where the bookcase is in the hallway, and the washing machine can't get past it. I really have to leave soon to make it to my appointment. "We could move the bookcase," I say. "It's not that heavy. Won't take that long at all." And the man in charge, who seems damper and angrier than the other guy, tells me that company policy says that they can't move furniture because of breakages and liability. And I nod my head. I know about company policies. I know he's right and there's nothing to be done. And then I roll my eyes and I'm rolling them at the company policies, not at him. Really, genuinely, I'm trying to show him I'm on his side. But he doesn't get it. He thinks I'm rolling my eyes at him. And he says I don't know anything and I can ring the company if I like, but he knows I'd probably sue if they broke anything. People do it all the time, which is why it's company policy. So I start taking everything off the bookcase and start moving it out of the way. It's really not that heavy, but it's a two-person job. And the guy who's not in charge tries to help me, but the other guy says, "Mate, if you injure yourself, company's not going to pay." And I say, "It's okay, I've got it. And I do have it. I have it. But what a stupid place to put the bookcase." They get the new washing machine to the laundry and there's a knock at the door. It's Joe from down the road, who needs to get somewhere. And he noticed the guys in the truck parked across the laneway delivering something to me, and could I get them to move? Both of the guys go back to the truck, annoyed with me again for choosing this stupid street to live in. I think back to Russell, who found the house on our long search for somewhere for the three of us when Bear was tiny and Poppy didn't exist. He'd said it was perfect for us, and that there were big, lovely trees and a park nearby, and this little laneway just down the road that led to a patch of green, like a small meadow. I'd come to look and the lane didn't lead to anything like a meadow, but it was a lovely street and a lovely house, and we'd made it ours. Poppy came not so long after that, and the girls both liked the patch of green and the park up the road and the big gum tree at the end of the street. If these guys hurry, if they really hurry, and there's not too much traffic, I'll make it to the appointment. But things have to now go perfectly, and it doesn't look like they will. I wonder if I should ring now for politeness sake to cancel, but there's still that small chance I'll make it. Won't have to pay the cancellation fee. The guys come back. I try to smile at them and keep them moving. But there's a problem installing the washing machine because they can't stack it on top of the dryer. The dryer is a whole other brand, you see, and they can't guarantee that the washing machine will fit properly. And again, there's a liability problem. I say, okay, just leave it there where it is and go. That's fine. I just need you to give me back the installation fee, that $200. For that, he says, I'll have to ring head office. I sigh deeply and say, of course. Because, of course, nothing in this whole arrangement could be easy. This is a statement of what I see as fact. It's a statement about this universe I found myself in, with a broken washing machine and a credit card debt and the rain and me who caused all these problems, and now I'm in charge of fixing them. He takes it personally. Hey, he says, this isn't my fault. This is company policy. I don't know why you have to be so uptight. It's just a washing machine. The panic rises in my chest. The panic and the exhaustion and these endless problems and the slaps that grief keeps giving me. So I cry in front of these men who I don't know, who won't help me. You don't need to cry, says the guy in charge. He says it in a way that's not exactly kind, but it's careful. My husband's gone, I say. I can't even say the word dead. I can't say that it was 3 years ago now, because 3 years feels so long. And why am I crying anyway? 3 years after he died, and when is this going to stop? The way it slaps me like this. And when will I start making sure the power's off and pay my debts and get out of the mess it feels like I'm in because he's gone? And when am I not going to feel so incredibly alone? The mood changes. We'll give it a go, says the man in charge. We can install it, I guess. Just don't tell the boss. I say, I won't tell the boss. I say, thank you. I say, I'm sorry. I say, I'm not sure why I said that. The one who's not in charge says to me, it's okay. My wife left me, and it was very hard. He says, I just need to look at the good things in life, see the positive. He's nice, but he's talking like a greeting card, and I think the other guy, who's now doing the installation alone, keeps looking over at him, as if he's ready to kill him. I see it as he tells me the story about his wife, about the way she decided it was over, all of a sudden. I nod, sympathetically, thinking that if he stopped talking, this would be much faster and I'd make it to my appointment. And he says, I know I'm not going to be alone forever. I know that. I nod, not knowing what to say, impressed by his confidence. And neither will you. You'll be fine. Thank you, I say, wondering if he's about to ask me out on a date, hoping he won't. The guy in charge clears his throat loudly, announces that he's done. I sign the paperwork as quickly as I can, tell them thank you. The guy in charge says, again, they can't guarantee that the washing machine will stay in place, and I mustn't tell the boss, and I have to realise, etc., etc. I look at my watch, tell them I've got to get moving, but I appreciate their help. I make it to the appointment 15 minutes late. As Elizabeth answers the doorbell, I'm shaking my umbrella out, holding it in the wrong direction, and I end up shaking out the rain directly onto her. Sorry, I say, oh God, sorry, I'm late and you're wet and I mean, I'm sorry. And I burst into tears. Elizabeth is my grief counsellor. She leads me to her room, which is small and cold. She's very kind, young, serious, terribly sympathetic. I sit on her couch and I start crying again. I tell her about the washing machine and how I plunged the house into darkness. And she takes notes, making kind, understanding noises. Through tears and gulps, I tell her about blurting out to those men who I don't know and who didn't want to help me about not having a husband. She asks what this brings up for me. I breathe in. I'm sick of it, I say. I'm sick of this feeling so bad. I'm sick of coming here to see her every week. She writes this down. 3 years, I say. I thought it would be over by now. I thought I would feel better. I wouldn't make the stupid mistakes I keep making, that it'd be okay. Does this ever stop? I ask her. And as always, she doesn't give me the answer I want. She gives me no time limit. She offers no promises. She's helpful and kind, but just like the installation of the washing machine back at home, there is no guarantee. We finish up making an appointment for next week, and the week after that, and the week after that. The girls get back from school that afternoon, and neither of them particularly want to listen to my story about the washing machine and all the tears I shed and the rude man who made me cry. Bear steals a look at Poppy, exasperated at my emotional response to this very humdrum story. That look is the beginning of something, although I don't know it yet. It gets more obvious over the next couple of years. A movement away from me, from all my feelings, my grief, and the way it imposes itself on their lives, just as they're trying to shake off the past and live new lives. And God, doesn't that hurt?
Thank you.
Goodbye to All This is produced by me, Sophie Townsend, and Eleanor McDowell. The music has been specially created for the podcast by Jeremy Wormsley. Alan Hall is the executive producer. The consultant story editor from CBC Podcasts is Chris Oak. The BBC World Service podcast editor is John Minnell. It's a Falling Tree production for the BBC World Service.